watching the Jennylyn Show, and I am Jennylyn Gleave, your host. Tonight, I am so happy to introduce you to my guest, Andreas Weigend. I was listening to the radio while I was doing my laundry and heard this gentleman on the phone discussing dildos and how you can gauge the amount of energy that it uses when you own one, and decided I had to have him on my show. Andreas?
Jenny, nice to be on your show, and I wanted to tell the story here about data. How the company called We Vibe was recording dildo data of your dildo or somebody else's dildo and making those by mistake public. So you could find out about somebody's activities by, you know, looking up on the internet. So I think the question for us really is, how can we make those data off the people and by the people, data for the people? How can we create a society where the social norms are embracing activities?
Yes, and so Andreas is the author of Data for the People, which is the book he was discussing on the radio when I heard him.
Doing your laundry.
Doing my laundry, and decided he had to come on my show. So I Googled his name, I got his contact information, and 2 weeks later, here he is. Hello. Where do we begin?
Well, from my side, I was just stepping out of that radio station as I looked at a Facebook message of a dear friend of mine. And he said, Andreas, can you call me? What happened to him was his bank account was emptied. And he thought he was living in this Kafkaesque world, where he said that he went online and Bank of America, where he banked, had a banner, a red banner saying, you need to come into a bank, into a branch office. So he was confused. He went to the branch office. They said, oh, we can't talk to you. You need to talk to the police. And at that stage, he got alarmed. And then the police said, no, we can't talk to you. We need to talk to the court. And at that stage, my poor friend, he really was getting worried. Emptied the bank account, needing to talk to the court. But then, smart as he is, he put everything together. Not just one plus one plus one, but many more things. It turned out there's another person whose name differs by one character in the English transliteration, and whose social security number differs with one unit, who had a court case against them in Los Angeles.
Are you
and
serious?
Somebody decided that guy here, my friend, is close enough. They must be cheating, and they emptied his bank account.
You're kidding me.
So for me, one of the key questions about data is, what do we do about mistakes? Mm-hmm. Particularly, what do we do about mistakes the government has about us?
Right. Is that what motivated this book?
Yeah. Because my dad spent many years in prison in East Germany because they thought he was an American spy. He had to sign things in Russian. He didn't speak Russian. And he never really knew why he got put into prison at the beginning into solitary confinement.
Wow.
So you might think that a story like that would make me a privacy zealot. But having thought about it, I think that we have more of a chance for fairness, mm-hmm. for justice, if our data is public. It's not 100% clear whether machinery like the dreadful machinery of the Third Reich, Hitler, whether he would have been even more efficient in killing people had data been out there about the citizens. I have the hope, however, that we can create a better world if we share data. Let me give you an example. DNA. What if each child, as it is born, had its DNA publicly uploaded?
Yes.
I think we could create the pressure, the social pressure as well as legislation, to prevent insurance companies from discriminating against people according to the DNA.
Right.
I mean, after all, they can't change their DNA. So if we learned from every interaction they have with the medical system, in addition to the DNA, if we can learn what makes them have certain diseases, maybe we are better off if we can share this data. But as I said, my worry is, what if a government comes that we do not trust anymore? What can we put into place so they cannot rule, they cannot use our data against us?
But don't you think there's a flip side to having too much information about you out there?
It really is, you know, up to us in this important point in history. Like, when I was born, what data was there about me? There was a birth certificate, mm-hmm. handwritten. Or even when I was in high school, all we really had were handwritten marks every half year.
But you grew up in Germany.
Yeah.
Do you have social security numbers in Germany?
No, we don't have social security numbers. And also the interesting thing is that passport numbers change from passport to passport.
Okay.
So we don't really have a persistent number which is associated with a person. And that makes it different in countries like China.
Right.
I also have a house in Shanghai, and I opened a bank account there with my old German passport. And then I got a new passport, and they said, but that's not you, that's a different number. So all I had was a copy of the old passport to allow me to access my funds. So who are we? Are we just a few digits? Or are we the union of all the data we created? Are we any more than the data we create?
But in Germany, if you don't have social security numbers and the only number that sort of identifies you is a passport, is everyone forced to have, is it mandatory that you have a passport?
No. Actually, to be honest, I left Germany to come to grad school. So I had to have a passport to get out of Germany and get to the US. So I don't honestly quite know how it works. But I know that the historic incidences, what history happens, whether it's in Germany or in China or the United States, deeply influence how people think about their data. So the EU is having a new data protection law,
right,
which really tries to put rights into place, the right to access your data. I push it further in the book. I have the right to inspect the refineries. For instance, here next door, Google is a data refinery. It's a wonderful data refiner. They take all the data in the world and they combine it in order to do what? In order to help you make better decisions for yourself. Mm-hmm. That for me is a data refinery. And that, for instance, when I was driving here, I used the Google navigation tool, Google Maps, and it tells me to turn left at the next intersection. And for that, I need to share with Google, one, where I am, and two,
where are you going?
Where I want to be going. Mm-hmm. So for me, a data refinery is something that has data that I give even more data in order for it to help me make a decision that is good for me. That's why I think agency, the ability to make decisions, is what all of this data for the people is about.
So as I'm listening to you, I can see where it would really help people to make better choices because they know it would be easier for them to get caught. But then on the other side, I'm thinking if everything we do and say is out there, yes, it's going to make us a bunch of paranoid beings. We're running around thinking, if I do this, people are going to know. I mean, how do you see that affecting people if we start doing that?
I know. The prologue starts and says, when everything is recorded. And I invite your viewers to take that view for a moment, that everything they said, everything they did was recorded forever. how would their behavior change?
Yes, that's my question.
That's a good question.
How do you think it will?
So, I think the key question is that of potentially questionable, let's say, illegal things. Let's say drug use. Mm-hmm. So if you think you do this in the four walls of your home, that's one thing. But if you knew that there are cameras that record that forever, that's another thing. Maybe we don't really need cameras. Let's take the example of Amazon Alexa, that little device sitting in my living room and listening to me. And I say, Alexa, and it wakes up and it figures out what I mean. Somewhere, those data is stored. I trust Amazon. I trust Google.
You worked for them at some point.
I worked for them. I was a chief scientist at Amazon.
Yes, I saw that.
Yeah. So
that's an honor. You were their chief scientist.
It was an honor. It was something which I would have never imagined in my life. Had I had a very clear trajectory, you know, being chief scientist at Amazon would have not been part of trajectory.
Right.
But it really was a wonderful opportunity to work with a wonderful human being, Jeff Bezos. And that's why I say I do trust Amazon. But a few weeks ago, the US government subpoenaed some Alexa records. That's where I get scared.
But why?
There was some criminal case and subpoenas, you know, by a court, they can try to get some evidence. Like you might have some documents at home, whatever. I'm not an expert in the law. But that's when I worry that something which was recorded innocently at home, didn't even think about it, then now the authorities come and take it, and then they maybe make a case against me.
I'm sorry, I'm laughing. So you...
I am not about this.
I know. I can laugh because I don't have Alexa.
You know, everybody wants to get into your bedroom. Mm-hmm. Amazon mm-hmm. through Alexa, Google through Nest,
right.
Apple through Siri, your hookup through Tinder. Mm-hmm. So, you know, that's how the world works.
So, well, when you worked for Amazon, you worked specifically with Alexa or you worked?
No, it was before Alexa existed.
Oh, okay. And what did you do then, if you're allowed to talk about
sure.
it?
Sure. So,
because
what
when
is...
I, sorry, when I read it on the in your bio, when I did my research, I thought, why does Amazon need a scientist?
Yeah. Because Amazon believes in this scientific method. Maybe our current president doesn't, but many people do. And I personally do believe in the scientific method. And that means doing experiments. My PhD was in physics. I got it here at Stanford doing research in neural networks.
Okay.
And there were two things I learned. One is that you need to ask good questions to get good answers.
Right.
And particularly in this world now where we have so much data, if you don't ask good questions, you won't get good answers.
Right.
So one of the mistakes is people to say, oh, we have all this data and now we're looking for answers in this data. No. We first have to figure out what questions do we have.
Right.
In science, we call this hypotheses. The other things I learned is it is very important that you have an equation which allows you to evaluate outcomes of experiments. So a couple of weeks ago, I was giving a colloquium at Stanford, and I really was reflecting on those 25 years since I did my PhD. And I realized that in my thesis, I was working on what objective function should we have to optimize our neural network. What should we train it on? How do we trade off different parts in that equation?
Right.
And that really has stayed with me throughout life. That I think as an individual, what should be my equation of life? How do I trade off short-term benefits versus long-term benefits? I work out almost every day. Not that I super enjoy it, but I think the trade-off is that when I grow old, I might be in better shape than if I didn't work out now.
Right.
or think about eating. You know, a second on the lip, a lifetime on the hip. You know how it goes with sweets. So those are trade-offs we make.
Right.
And I think that is just the individual equation. Then, more importantly, I think, for a community-based audience is the equation of society. How do we allocate scarce resources? Education. Who do we give an education to? It's not free. Or even nearby here, parking. How do we allocate parking spots? Should we let companies that have a little app on your phone which says, you barista, if you move your car within the next 3 minutes, some rich guy will give you $20 because he needs a parking spot right now. Do we think that is fair? Maybe it is. Maybe the barista makes a little bit more money. Maybe it isn't because it's a public utility. Or think about healthcare. Let's say you need a liver. Who from the many people needing a liver should be getting that next liver through an organ donor which becomes available? Those are the questions. In the case of liver, smart, well-meaning people at the Mayo Clinic got together 10, 20 years ago and came up with a MEL score, which is a score for each patient. Like, what is the quantity of life?
Right.
What is the quality of life? Maybe what are her contributions, the contributions she has made, the contributions she will make if she gets that liver, and so on. And they decided that money is not part of that equation. On the other hand, have you been on the dark web?
No. I think I know what the dark web is. Yes. I don't think I've been. Should I? Should I have
gone? I think everybody should check out the dark web.
Why?
I think it's a word out there which is worth understanding, or at least knowing that it exists. A friend of mine from Caltech, a few months ago, he sat me down one evening and said, Andreas, I think I want to show you how the dark web works. And if I have a suggestion for your viewers, if you really want to know what's going on in the world, spend a couple of hours and see how that world works.
Tell me in a nutshell, what did you learn from the dark world?
I learned that the algorithms that Amazon developed for recommending items, that the algorithms Amazon developed for rating items, mm-hmm. for rating and ranking sellers, that they don't only apply to Amazon and the things you can buy at Amazon, that they apply pretty much to everything, including the things you can buy on the dark web. But I don't want to influence your viewers. Let's have them find it out themselves.
Well, he has planted the seed. Do your homework if you need to find out, if you're curious like me. So, my last guest was an artificial intelligence expert. In fact, he's the CEO of a new artificial intelligence company called Leela. What do you think of this whole concept of equality where you pretty much don't need to use your brain because they're going to artificially devise intelligence that will make everybody equal?
So, I don't think that that is quite the notion of AI. So, I think that for me, it is helping us being smarter by having computers learn. So, my general view is that people should be doing what people are good at. Computers should be doing what computers are good at, and it's not wise to confuse the two. So AI for me means helping us do the things which we do well even better.
But based on what he told me, it sounds like Amazon is using a lot of that, in that if you look at something on your computer a little hard,
exactly.
With a little bit more energy than flipping through, somehow they know And it pops up every time you go on your computer.
So I teach a course, and I love teaching, at the University of California at Berkeley.
Okay.
And the course is called Social Data Revolution.
Okay.
And all the classes I've taught for the last 10 years or so are on my YouTube channel.
Okay.
YouTube.com/Social Data Revolution. Because I really believe that things should be accessible. It should make it easy for people who want to learn things to learn things.
Except Alexa.
No, I think for people, I really don't believe in building up walls.
Okay.
I think we are better off by sharing what we have, including our data, than trying to make it difficult to access it.
But don't you think we should have some privacy?
I do think we should have privacy. And I think, for example, today I got several spam calls.
Mm-hmm.
You know, calls from numbers, not even anymore unknown, but numbers, and you answer them, and somebody wants to, you know, maybe sometimes in the pretense of doing some market research, but usually not even that, bother you. That, for me, is an intrusion of privacy. And I think I'm actually surprised, because on the network level, going back to AI here, on the network level, it is easy to understand who the culprits are. And if somebody wants to actually suppress it, they can.
That's what I was going to ask you. With all of the research and all of the development, how come they can't find these telemarketers, scammers that harass us? Somebody needs to put some focus on it.
This term here, it is the economy. That ultimately, it's the question about the economics of, in this case, the economics of spam.
Uh-huh.
And we do live in a post-privacy economy. So that means for me that it is a fact that we really don't have privacy. If you think about it, you can't really get through a few days without having your image captured through some CCTV camera, or without using your mobile phone, or without looking at your email, or without Googling something. So that, as we know, we need to get over it. But the questions that are about the economics of it. So another loop we needed to close is the loop about Amazon and AI.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason I was just going to talk to you about my class at Berkeley is that we had a company come to class last year called Emotient. They were bought by Apple. And they can figure out with a video camera what you are really thinking. How you feel. Are you happy?
Are you faking it?
And not only for one person, but I learned in that class that for a room full of 400 people, a high-resolution camera can pick out each and every one of them's emotion. That is scary.
Very frightening.
Yeah.
So you can't even think in peace.
So think about United, the airline.
Right.
They're still in business, right?
I think they had another disaster yesterday.
So if you think about how cameras could change how people do their job, or how AI could change what emails the CEO sends, some sentiment analysis on an email could help prevent the disaster he created. So sometimes I think people are just not aware of the tools, or not enough aware of the tools, or maybe they overestimate themselves
mm-hmm.
of how they can be empathetic or something like that.
Yes.
And they're rather than being empathetic, they're more pathetic.
Mm-hmm. Well, because they've developed so many bad habits that are going to be forced to change when they have to always be conscious and cognizant of the fact that everything they say and do can be accessed. We're down to 5 minutes. I don't mean to cut you off. We're down to 5 minutes. I want to make sure we get all the juicy stuff in there before we get a wrap. What you want to make sure you leave with my viewers so that we can spend the rest of the time getting the key facts in that we may not have covered?
So I think data literacy is something very important to me. Mm-hmm. That I think data, the value of data is the impact it has on decisions.
Right.
So I want your viewers to demand from companies the tools that helps them make better decisions. And as I said before, better not by the metrics of the chief marketing officer of the company, but better by the metrics of the viewer, of the individual. We live in an amazing time where individuals have more power than they ever had. We want the tools so we can actually understand the impact of our data.
And curb their enthusiasm. I just said to someone today, it's very rare where someone in power doesn't end up becoming corrupt. So I think with some of these new measures, they may kind of tame the shrew a little bit, so to speak. What do you think?
I don't know. For me, it is more important to be clear to people that the world is not black and white.
Okay.
The world is not a binary place. It is about trade-offs. And trade-offs aren't always easy to communicate. But the reason I wrote the book is I want people to be clear what trade-offs they need to make. I mean, not making decisions, also making decisions. But we, as humans, we are the decisions we make. So I want people to make them, whether it's about individuals or about society, in a way that reflects their values, that reflects the weights they put into the different terms in their equation.
Thank you so much. I don't like this part of my interviews. When it's getting so good, I have to wrap. Thank you so much for watching The Jennylyn Show. I hope that you are going to learn a lot from what Andreas has shared with me. And just remember, they're watching everything we do now. Remember, every action has a consequence. Thanks again for watching my show, and I will see you next time.